Hello, good evening, my dear friends, fellow travelers, and photographers. Chris Lee here. Welcome to my travel channels. In today's episode, I'm going to share with you a beautiful province in China. And this province was less visited by tourists for certain reason. But however, today I'm going to share with you this interesting province which cover some of the unique cultures and tradition, basically fall into two main unique minority groups, the Miao and the Dong unique groups. So welcome to Chris Lee Travel Channels. So in today I will bring you to an ancient town in Guizhou province, and besides sharing the beautiful historical background and scenery, I also will share with you some very beautiful night scenery as can be seen in this slide. And in addition to that, I will bring you to a river cruise and to have an understanding of the local topographies and landscapes. So this will be basically covered in today's episode. And for your information, this tour to Guizhou province will consist of 11 episodes. And today is the first episode of my tour to Guizhou province in China. So to get to know about whereabout is Guizhou, if you look at this map in front of you, the red dot, the red area is actually the Guizhou province. So Guizhou is a mountainous and landlocked province in southern China. Now the province has a land area of approximately 170,000 square kilometers with a population of around 38.5 million in the year 2020. And Guiyang is actually the provincial capital of Guizhou. So this mountainous province has 85% of its land area under high plateaus, and the mountainous region with dense networks of rivers and valleys, now thus produce a very complex topography rarely found in other provinces of China. Now with the high altitudes in the west and center and low toward the east and south region as shown in this topography map in front of you, so you can see that the brownish color are referred to a highlands, yet the yellowish are referred to a lower ground, but however still on the high plateau, because the actual low area is actually those area color in green, but it's all outside the province boundary. Now a relatively poor and economically underdeveloped province, the wealth of the people have significantly improved over the last decade. You have thanks to the China government. So this map are showing to you the the location of the provincial capital, the Guiyang, is located exactly at the center of the province. And the climates of Guizhou is of typical tropical monsoon style, with mild short winters and hot humid summers and high rainfalls, particularly during the warmer month, which is basically during the month of June and August each year. Now among the provinces have large number of minority ethnic groups, Guizhou has been regarded as the most diverse province. Now, the minority groups account for more than 37% of the population, which are approximately 14.245 million. Now, among the minority ethnic groups, Miao has the largest population, followed by Dongs, Tujia, Yi, Hui, Yao, and Buyi, and as well as the Zhuang ethnic groups. Of course, there have many more minority ethnic groups. Now, the huge population of multi-ethnic minority brought about abundance of intangible cultures, authentic lifestyles, right? Exotics, costumes, and artistic songs and dance. Now, Guizhou province has been regarded as the kingdoms of innate minority groups. And Guizhou is, of course, famous among tourists for its intangible cultures of minority innate groups and the peaceful and beautiful countryside, villages, and landscape, which I'm going to present to you in the following episode, starting from today. So, our journey will begin with touring the South-eastern Guizhou and cover this province. And this province is called Dongnan, Miao and Dong Autonomous Prefectures, right? And to know about exactly where the location of these prefectures between the Guizhou province, as shown in this map, you can see that it's actually at the south-eastern most prefecture location among the other prefectures between the province. So the first ancient town that I have shown shared with you just now, that I intend to share with you, is this ZhenYuen ancient town. But before I go into the ZhenYuen ancient town, where this town is located in these prefectures, I want to share with you about these prefectures. Now, this Qingdongnan Miao and Dong Autonomous Prefectures is located in the southeastern part of Guizhou province, and the prefecture have 81.3% of its populations belong to innate minority, and Miao took up 43.2%, and the other major innate group is Dong, take up 30.4%. And when we visit these regions, we are actually trying to explore the culture of these major innate groups in this region. And most Miao and Dong villages are scattered around Kaili, Rongjiang, Chongjiang, Zhaoxing, and most part of also southeastern Guizhou. So now we are now looking at the picture of a ZhenYuen ancient town. And this ZhenYuen ancient town is actually located in ZhenYuen County. Now, ZhenYuen ancient town is of Miao minority groups in China. It is also the capital of ZhenYuen County, located in the prefecture that I've been mentioned numerous times. Now, a 2,000 years old ancient town in southeastern Guizhou, located next to Wuyang River, which cut through the town in the S-shape, forming a yin yang or Bagua symbol. Now, popularly known as the Oriental Venice for some travelers. Now, the town is divided into two zones, namely the full city at the north and the Wei city at the south. Now, the entire town covers only about 3.1 square kilometers of land area. Now, and within just a small area, the town has more than 160 historical and scenic spots to offer to its visitors. Now, the town featuring numerous ancient buildings built during the Ming Dynasty, which started in 1368 to 1644, and the Qing Dynasty in 1644 till 1912. Now, the popular spot, including the Qinglongdou, which translates into a green dragon cave in English, is an ancient architecture complex of ancient temple, pavilion, shrine, and palace, which built on the foothill and cliff of so-called the Zhongne Mountains next to the Wuyang River. So, this is the location of this ZhenYuen County, if you look at the map now in front of you, the arrow pointed to. And this is the map of this ancient town, right? You can see from the image there, The river was highlighted in arrow pointing to, and you can see that this river is actually dividing the town into two parts, and the river is winding and in the S shape, as what I mentioned just now, in the shape of yin yang. So what you are seeing in the image here now is actually the Wuyang River. And these images were taken during the early mornings. I believe it's about just about 6:30 to 7 o'clock. And the town is still quite deserted. And it's rainless morning. And you can see that the river water surface form a perfect piece of mirror. And this is one of the bridges that crossing this Wuyang River. We're joining the northern and the southern part of the city. So when we are there in that early morning, you can see that actually even this square that's just next to the river was still deserted. And the street is, of course, is with very few pedestrians. And when we come back to this part of the river bank, you can see that now we have found some retired ladies are having their morning exercise. And this is a common scene in China. So more images of those rivers at the bank of the rivers that cutting through this ZhenYuen town. From the scene, you notice actually why the river cutting through the town. You can see that on the side of the river, basically is a hill. You know, you can see that that's why Guizhou has been considered one of the most mountainous provinces in China. They have very little flatlands, but more on have rivers and valley. And this is the reason why making the landscape here is so unique. Now in this image, you just see that at the cliff of these mountains, and which basically mentioned the Zhonghe San, the mountains, where the location of this Qinglong Dong is located. You can see the row of buildings, and those buildings that built on the cliff and the slope of the cliff. So these are all the sceneries that are taken at about 10 or 11 a.m. in the morning. And probably our visit is not during the peak seasons. You can find that most of the tourist boats was still not operating at these hours of the day. So what you see now is actually all this ancient building that actually located between the so-called the complex that I mentioned just now, the Qinglong Dong complex area. And the complex housed a number of ancient buildings, namely the Zhongyuan Si temple, and then Yuewang Ge is basically is the translated as the Jade Emperor's pavilions. Then we also Ziyang Shuyan actually is the Academy of Classical Learning Center, and also the Xiangjiuyuan is a longevity palace. And the building complex are well presented, and the cultures, and it also have high inheritation of the cultures of Buddhism, Taoism, and Confucianism. And with magnificent construction, architectures, and layout. And the nearby the city is actually have a lot of interesting ancient building structures. And one of them is actually the Zhusen Qiao, a seven-hole arch bridge that built of blue stone, not a very dark blue type, but it's very light blue stone during the Ming Dynasty, spanning across the Wuyang River, and also the Tianhou Si, which is actually a temple, and also traditional fox houses, which rich in traditional Southern Fujian architectures and ancient well nearby within the Old City District. Now, Wuyang River is been regarded as the mother rivers, but also the soul of the city. When the night fall, the dwellings and shops along the riverbank, including the historical bridges and also building complexes on the cliff of these Zhonghe mountains, will be lighted up and with multicolored lights. It's an excellent spot for night photography, a stroll at the night market nearby the riverbank is not a bad idea either. So we will see more images. These are the building that I mentioned that is actually at the so-called the Green Dragon Cave. And this image was taken on the bridge, the Zhuzhen Bridge, the ancient bridge, the seven-hole arch bridge. And this is actually the arch bridge. During the day, it looked very plain, but when at night, when lighted up, it's very, very beautiful and interesting, which I'm going to share with you before the end of this episode. It's a pagoda that built on top of this ancient bridge. And this is the few street that just next to the river. And you can see that from the image, these buildings that's built here are basically a few hundred years old. As I say, that some of that even was built during the Ming Dynasty, that is in the 14th century. So it's about 600 years ago. The street is still relatively free of traffic during our visit in the morning. Please take especially on the roof structures, you know. It's very, very unique and very stand out. And we happened to pop by to one of the ancient buildings, mostly constructed of woods. And then we later on realized actually this is actually a hotel's ancient building converted into a hotel's. And we have been allowed to do a visit to these hotels. The carving work is very, very unique and outstanding. And the lady on the image on the right is actually the hotel staff. You know, she came up and greeted us, and we did ask some info pertaining to the rental rates, you know, per rooms and things like that. And she's very friendly and answer all these our questions. And this is actually the door that entered to this hotel 4 years. All these are couples hundred of years of age, I believe. And as I say that this is a historical town, so you can see that most of the signboard put up in a shop that are very, very outstanding and unique, which also considered very, very rare to have this type of signboards. This town seems to be one of the popularity or craftsmanship is basically the carving. So you can see that they have a lot of wooden carving works done by these artisans and for sale. You can buy some of these as your souvenir. And this is a wine shop, and you can find there are more than 30 variety of wine for sale, and you just order according to your requirements. And there are also wine that have been stored in the bamboo built or bamboo container can be seen in this image. Another major popular products on sale along this street are actually the silk and also the local costume. This is one type of candy. Is basically, you can see the man on the right is pulling the candy before it's hardened, and it seems to be a mix of sugar with milk and some other form of ingredients, and they keep pulling it over and over and hundreds of times, then make until the grain get very much finer and finer. Then upon hardened, then they just chop into small little piece as just like a sweet or candy that for sale, as the lady is doing the chopping now into small pieces. And you can also find some street food, like in this case is a roast tofu. And another important major food of the local that consume in the morning is pao. And we also make a tapao, and we also pack some, you know, along the way. And one important feature that you have to note is that in this town, the tables that placed by most of these shops are very, very low. I can see from this image. And the table is hardly higher than 450 millimeters or 1.5 feet above ground. Then you have a very small short tools, stools for us to sit on. And this is actually the style that practicing in this town. This shop selling noodles. And when we close to about 10, 11 a.m. in the morning, the streets start getting busy. You find that a lot of shops have opened, and the streets start getting more boisterous and also more visitor. And you also can find some villages from surrounding around these townships or in the rural area come forward to sell their crops, the harvest, right? Like for instance, this lady is selling their vegetable to the store owner. And for the elderly retired person, they prefer to sit on near to the street at the open air, because I think the weather here is quite pleasing, because it's around 20 plus degrees Celsius, and particularly in the morning it's much cooler. So there are some bench and seat that's placed along in the middle of the street so that they can sit on it. Some of you prefer to play mahjong. For some, even just sitting there and lazing off, watching the pedestrian passing by. As for the children, those are before the school, preschool children, then of course they will have their own way of spending the time. But for the school children, they are, once the school is over, they will also gather around the street and have fun. And being a construction man for all these years, I pay very attention to how I'm very curious of how they construct, because this is one of the shop lots they are under rebuilding. And you can find that most of the workers at the time, 10 years ago, half of them are ladies. I realize actually, although they are casting a two-story, in fact they are building a three-story building, and they are now casting the second floor, you know, the slab. You can see they're using a pulley trolley as a means of hoisting, and they're using the wheelbarrows as their supporting basket, and using the pulley to pull it up to the second floor level for placing of the concrete. What a unique style, and all manually done. And because this is an ancient town and a lot of works are rely heavily on stone, so both the pavement, the roads, and some of the buildings are actually constructed of stone. So you can see this artisan or this craftsman is slowly carving these stone blocks, right? And then place it on the donkey to carry to the place for placement. And this is exactly still taking place during our visit, and we saw this 10 years ago. All manually handled, you know, crafted. That each piece of this stone block are manually crafted. They are chiseled bit by bit to ensure the squareness. And this is the night scene, alright? So when night fall, we do a visit to the street. And you can see the building, the some of those on Main Street are all been lighted up with yellowish, goldish light. And this is the reason why I say for night photography, this is the best spot for photograph. They tend to light the street using the yellowish light, you know. Tend to give it a goldish color look. Certain street, the lighting is a bit dim, but of course equally attractive. And the images on the left is actually one of the old street. And in this street, you find that there's still a lot of those store, mobile store, being set up. So the shop on the left is actually selling the sale. And this is some of the alley that we pass by. You know, it's well decorated with beautiful light up lanterns. And this is the Wuyang, ZhenYuen, the river, the Wuyang River at night. It's unfortunately during my visit that I did not carry a so-called a tripod, or rather I'm lazy to bring out from my hotels. I have to use whatever means to stabilize my camera to take all these nice shots. Because our visit is on the 17th day of the Lunar New Year, so we still managed to see a full moon above this Wuyang River. So you can see actually the night scene along the riverbank is the most interesting of the entire trip to this ancient town. Now you can see this ancient bridge, the Chusen Chang, the seven hole, and they've been lighted up with multicolors. While all those old ancient buildings on the cliff of this The green dragon cave regions are equally been lighted up. This is exactly when you see in the morning that these are the buildings that on the cliff of a side of the hill, right? Now it's been lighted up. In this image shown that it's turned into a bluish colors, light been lighted up. Now you have a so-called a pinkish red color and another color. So actually the color keep changing. Every 10 or 20 seconds, I did not really do a check on how long each color lasts before they change. Now it's green colors. So you have a chance to see all these colors that change on this beautiful riverside. So for photographer, if you want to have a better and nicer images as not as me that did not bring a tripod, please make sure get yourself a tripod, handy tripod, when you visit this ancient town for the night scene. So that is all. Then you move on to the next section of this episode of today. That is actually the Wuyang River's river cruise. And I will strongly recommend that if you are somebody that do not like nature, probably this river cruise you can skip. But as far as I'm concerned, that this river cruise with the intention to let you have a better understanding, all right, of the local topography in these regions. And so when we came to this town, of course, this is part of the itinerary, and I found that actually the river cruise is not very excited as far as I'm concerned, because it's just strictly a river cruise. And which I'm going to share with you thereafter. But importantly, that it's very, very leisure. If you are like the leisure life, then you just can lazy off yourself. But for us, a photographer, we expect some very interesting images. Then you can find that this river cruise may not be that attractive to us. But anyway, I still managed to capture some images that, in my opinion, is not bad, right? So these are the place where we disembark for the river cruise. And this is the boat that we'll be riding on. Now the river cruise took us about 2.5 hours, which covered a portion of the river about 2.25 kilometers. That means we are traveling along the Wuyang River for about 25 kilometers. From and back, actually, we are traveling about 50 kilometer long of a river cruise between 2.5 hours. So this will be the images taken along the cruise to this Wuyang River. So basically, you see that all the mountains that's next to the rivers have very sharp cliff, and therefore you can see that this proven these regions, this Guizhou province is a very heavily mountainous regions. It can be seen even during this river cruise. This is another tourist boat on the way. When we are coming back, they are in, right? And just to share with you that if you want to visit to this ZhenYuen ancient town, I hope that you can capitalizing on a Dragon Boat Festival, which is held normally each year on 25th of May. And indeed, it's one of the major festivals in this ZhenYuen town. So if you are coming to this part of the world, you can schedule your traveling time to fall into this Dragon Boat Festival. Please do check and confirm which date is the Dragon Boat Festival in ZhenYuen, then plan your trip so that you can have one stone kill two birds, you know, besides visiting the town, have a chance to enjoy, to join into their local festival. But of course, when the journey to this river cruise, disembark point, is quite a distance from the parking area, the main roads. So we also need to do some trekking. But of course, it's very easy trekking. All been well paved roads, small path, as you can see from this image. And at the same time, by going to the jetty point, you know, then you find that there are some hawker stall. And as I mentioned just now, remember I told you that the tables they use are fairly low in level. And you can see from the image here now, the bowl table on this image are all very, very low. This is a generous way of this setting up the table. You know, this is a standard adopted locally. Everybody sit low, right? So this is about all for what I'm going to share with you today. And if you like my travel journey and travel logs, please subscribe, share, and like. All right? I need your thumb up because it's important to me. And in the next episode to come, I'm going to bring you a very interesting part in Guizhou. And it's also the reason why we came to this part of the world during the month of April, because during the month of April or during the lunar calendars, the March, the third month of lunar calendar, that at the middle of the month there will be a very important festival. It's called Miao Sister Festival, and this is the festival that attracts us coming to this part of the country in China. So please stay tuned. I'm going to share with you in this coming episode the Miao Sister Festival. And please stay tuned and stay safe. See you in the next episode. And bye.